Thank you, Mr. President, for convening this emergency meeting. We thank Lebanon and Algeria for requesting this meeting. We also thank Mr. Caldo and Mr. Tork for their briefing. We welcome the presence of His Excellency Mr. Abdullah Abu Habib, Minister for Foreign Affairs and Immigrants of Lebanon, in this meeting. Mr. President, Member of the Security Council, this meeting is requested to address systematic and provocative act of terror committed by occupying regime of Israel on September 17 and 18 in Beirut, Lebanon, as well as in a part of Syria, deliberately targeting innocent civilians, including children. The method of this barbaric attack was unprecedented, as it was covertly handheld communication device was deliberately detonated, resulting in loss of at least 37 civilian lives and injuring thousands more, most likely of them injured from their eyes, including Iran's ambassador. Despite concerns by international community, this regime continues its aggression against the sovereignty and territorial integrity of Lebanon and Syria. Just this morning, an air strike targeted the residential areas in Zahia, a densely populated suburb of Beirut, causing civilians casualties and loss of life. Mr. President, targeting thousands of people across various age groups in densely populated area of Beirut, whatever in their home, streets, workplaces, or shopping centers, is a clear act of terrorism and a flagrant violation of international law, in particular international humanitarian human rights law and numerous resolutions of this body, especially resolution on the protection of civilians. These widespread and systematic crimes aimed at mass killing, severe suffering and serious injury to civilians constitutes crimes against humanity. Reports suggest that Israel intended to kill at least 5,000 civilians, while some devices either undistributed or deactivated. The Israeli barbaric attack has left Lebanon hospitals and medical staff in an unprecedented state of emergency, and attacks have sparked widespread fear and panic across Lebanon. Undoubtedly, Israel bears full responsibility for the perpetration of such horrific crimes. The repercussions of this attack extend far beyond Lebanon's border. The targeting of communication devices in the heart of Beirut sends a clear message to the international community. Israel is willing to commit any crime, no matter how extreme, to violate and attack the sovereignty and security of countries in the region and threaten regional and international peace and security. The Islamic Republic of Iran condemns in the strongest term these horrible and barbaric attacks. We extend our deepest condolences and sympathies to the people and the government of Lebanon and the families of the victims of this heinous terrorist attack. We wish a swift and full recovery to the injured and reaffirm our unwavering solidarity with our Lebanese brothers and sisters. Mr. President, the attack on our ambassadors is a blatant violation of international law and diplomatic norms. The protection of diplomatic personnel is a fundamental principle of international relations. The Israeli terrorist attack has flagrantly violated the 1961 Vienna Convention on Diplomatic Relations and 1973 Convention on the Prevention and Punishment of Crimes Against International Protected Persons, including diplomatic agents. We will rigorously pursue accountability for the attack on our ambassador in Lebanon. We reserve our right under international law to take all necessary measures to respond to this egregious violation. Unfortunately, this council has remained silent in the face of ongoing Israeli aggression and illegal actions, including the attack on Iran's diplomatic mission in Syria on 1 April 2024. Now again, this regime has crossed a red line by targeting our ambassador. Mr. President, let us not forget that these atrocious crimes against the people of Lebanon are part of a broader pattern of aggressive policy by Israeli regime. The Islamic Republic of Iran has repeatedly warned about the serious repercussions of malicious activities of the Israeli regime in the region. For the sake of regional peace, security, and the so-called ceasefire talks, the Islamic Republic of Iran has consistently shown maximum restraint. However, Israeli atrocities, from the ongoing genocidal war against the Palestinian people and occupation of Palestinian territories, to illegal strike in Syria and Lebanon, on the attack on Iran diplomatic mission in Syria, and covertly assassination of Palestine's former prime minister and the political leader of Hamas in Tehran, demonstrate an Israeli relentless commitment to destabilizing the region and threatening international peace and security. Mr. President, the gravity of Israeli atrocities against the people of Lebanon must be recognized not just as an attack on Lebanon, but as a threat to peace and security across the region. We must ask ourselves, how much longer will be the international community allow such atrocious crime to go unchecked? For decades, Israel has engaged in a pattern of aggressive actions aimed at destabilizing the region, whether through military operation, sabotage, or direct attack on civilians. This continuous aggression endangers the peace and security of the Middle East, fueling cycles of violence and further entrenching conflict. Regrettably, the Security Council has failed in its duty to maintain international peace and security. Israel's malevolent activities are often overlooked or outright supported by certain Western nations. Unwavering political, military, and economic support provided to Israel by the United States and its allies emboldens this regime to continue its violations without fear of accountability. This unconditional support, coupled with the deliberate blocking of any international effort to hold Israel responsible, has created an environment of impunity. The international community must not ignore the role of the Western countries, in particular the United States and UK, play in enabling Israel aggressions. These heinous crimes once again shown the Israeli leadership has no intention to adhering to international norms or the so-called ceasefire negotiations, frequently referenced by the United States in this council as being near resolution. The international community, and particularly this council, has a duty to confront not only the direct perpetrators of such crimes, but also those who provide them with the means and political cover to commit them. The failures of this body to hold Israel accountable has only emboldened the regime, allowing it to continue its aggressive and unlawful behavior. The Islamic Republic of Iran stands firmly with the government and the people of Lebanon, and we will not rest until those responsible for these atrocities are held accountable. We reaffirm our commitment to upholding the principles of international law and the Charter of the United Nations. However, it is incumbent upon this Council to act to stand up for justice, for peace, and the protection of innocent civilians. In conclusion, Mr. President, I categorically reject the baseless accusation made by the representative of the Israeli regime against my country. The representative of this terrorist regime, led by a notorious prime minister who is under arrest warrant by the International Criminal Court for the commission of war in Gaza, consistently relies on lies and disinformation to evade responsibility and to shift blame onto others. The very foundation of this regime is rooted in aggression, occupation, terror, and genocide. So nobody will take seriously this unfounded claim. I thank you.
I thank the representative of the Islamic Republic of Iran for their statement. I give the floor to the representative of the Syrian Arab Republic.
Shukran, Sayyid Rais. Sayyid Rais, udli bihaza al-bayan.
Thank you, Mr. President. I deliver the statement on behalf of the Arab Group of the United Nations here in New York. I wish to thank you for having positively responded to the request from the brotherly country of Algeria, a member of the Security Council, for the convening of this emergency meeting to address the most recent escalation in the ongoing Israeli escalation against the fraternal people of Lebanon over the past year. I welcome the presence of the Foreign Minister of Lebanon, Mr. Abdullah Abu Habib. Mr. President, on Tuesday and Wednesday, on the 17th and 18th of September, last, Lebanon was targeted by targeted assassinations by Israel, targeting thousands of Lebanese civilians throughout the country. At the same time, as thousands of beepers and walkie-talkies exploded, resulting in the deaths of 37 people and 3,250 wounded. Many of these people remain in critical condition. The Israeli occupation entity, through the perpetration of this heinous crime, has continued to escalate its aggression and terrorism, targeting Lebanese civilians, targeting them, targeting their families, in their homes, in public spaces, without the slightest consideration for the principles of international law, international human rights law, and the very basic principles of humanity and civilization. The brutality of the attack by the Israeli entity is nothing new, Mr. President. This entity, since its inception, perpetrated bloodshed, sowing horror. What is new, however, is the manipulation of modern-day technology, equipment that and devices that have been used for the well-being of people. These devices are now being used to perpetrate collective murder of civilians. The entity, the occupying entity, used commonplace devices for civilian purposes, used for civilian purposes in various sectors, and transformed these devices into ticking time bombs, killing those holding them without any distinction, sowing devastation around them. In this way, generating tremendous suspicion vis-a-vis the reliability and the safety of communications devices. The authorities of the Israeli occupying power last month used cyber attacks to intercept air traffic, civilian air traffic, imperiling the safety of passengers in Lebanese airspace. And this resulted in disruptions in the civilian operating system, resulting in the piracy of electronic devices, as well as of vital devices and applications. These are crimes that elucidate Israel's contempt for civilian life and international law. The Arab group condemns in the strongest terms the Israeli terrorist acts against the fraternal Lebanese people. We call for accountability for the perpetrators of these crimes. We extend our deepest condolences to the families of the victims. And we wish a speedy recovery to the injured. We extend our full solidarity with Lebanon, our full support for its resistance and its fight against Israeli aggression, which threatens its security and stability, which also represents an additional burden at a time when Lebanon is tackling many challenges in many sectors, including the health sector. The Arab group demands that the Security Council condemn this Israeli cyber terrorism, this ongoing aggression against the brotherly Lebanese people, which is part and parcel of the acts of genocide that are being perpetrated, ethnic cleansing, as well as systematic violations of international law being perpetrated by the Israeli occupying entity against the Israeli Palestinian people in the Gaza Strip and the West Bank. And we condemn aggressions against countries in the region, including Syria. The Arab group reiterates that Israeli acts of aggression will not stymie the desire, the commitment of our people to our attachment to the legitimate rights to liberate territory. We demand that the Security Council meet its responsibility for the maintenance of international peace and security, and we demand an end for it to demand an end to this aggression, for the Security Council to enforce the relevant resolutions to end the Israeli occupation of Arab territories in Palestine, Syria, and Lebanon. The Arab group holds the Israeli occupying entity as for fully accountable for any escalation, any situation that results in full-blown war in the region. Mr. President, I now wish to deliver the following remarks in my national capacity. The Syrian delegation aligns itself with a statement of the Arab group. Syria condemns the aggression and the ongoing terrorism against the Lebanese people, including cyber terrorism, which claimed the lives of dozens, injuring thousands, including the Iranian ambassador to Lebanon. We also condemn the barbaric aggression which targeted the south suburbs of Beirut, claiming the lives of 12 people, including children, which resulted in 66 people being wounded. Syria reaffirms its full solidarity with the fraternal Lebanese people, and we call upon all peoples throughout the world to condemn the Israeli aggression against Lebanon and to act to put an end to this and to demand accountability for the authorities, the occupying authorities, for the crimes perpetrated. Furthermore, we believe that states supporting Israel, the United States first and foremost, shoulder full responsibility for the ongoing Israeli occupation, its acts of aggression, its barbaric crimes, as well as obstruction at the Security Council, preventing the Security Council from upholding its responsibility to counter threats posed by the occupying power, threats to international peace and security. To conclude, there is a single reason for the instability in the region, that is the Israeli occupation of Arab lands in Palestine, in the Syrian Golan, and in South Lebanon. The Al-Majd al-Shams, which is the representative of the occupation, has tried to manipulate history. These are children who are Syrian children residing in the occupied Syrian Golan, who aspire, as do their families, to live freely, for the Golan to return to Syria. The solution in the region can only, the resolution in the region can only lie through an end to the occupation, Israel's cessation to the systematic violations of international law. Thank you.
I thank the representative of the Syrian Arab Republic for their statement. I now give the floor to His Excellency, Mr. Abdallah Bouhabib, Minister of Foreign Affairs and Immigrants of Lebanon.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, President.
First, I want to thank the Undersecretary DiCarlo and High Commissioner Turk for their presentations, as well as thank all members of the Council for acknowledging the severity and devastating consequences of the electronic attacks on peace and security of the fate and the fate of the humanity. Sayyid Rais,
Mr. President, Excellencies, no one in this world is safe anymore in the aftermath of the electronic attacks which were carried out recently in Lebanon. Those were unfathomable attacks. They have led to the injuring of thousands of innocent civilians, including children, women, and elderly. The responsibility of the Security Council is not only towards the innocent Lebanese who were targeted unjustly, but also towards humanity as a whole. If this terrorist attack is not condemned by your council, and if you do not name the perpetrator, if you do not deter the perpetrator, condemn it, and compel it to stop such aggressions, the credibility of this council, of international law, and of human rights law are at stake. Accepting what happened amounts to opening a Pandora box. Indeed, states and extremist groups will follow suit and will be targeting civilians everywhere with these lethal technologies. No one can prevent them from using these technologies in the future to target civilian planes, trains, and to kill civilians and indiscriminately terrorize them without discrimination. Isn't this terrorism when you target a whole population in their cities, streets, markets, shops, homes, while they tend to their daily life, while they are not fighting on the front? To understand what happened, it is enough to look into the identity of the victims. Are we seeking today the annihilation of the Lebanese people and its collective punishment? It is our right to ask, isn't this the scenario that was stated by senior Israeli officials? Look at the ugliness of what has happened in these pictures. I apologize for this picture. To highlight what has happened and its consequences, on Tuesday, the 17th of September 2024, Israel carried out a wide-scale electronic attack targeting thousands of pagers, detonating them. On the following day, Israel once again detonated hundreds of walkie-talkies. On the 19th of September, Israel also terrorized the population of Beirut and other regions when warfare broke the sound barrier repeatedly, unleashing fear and panic, especially among children. Today, Israel carried out a missile attack in one of the most densely populated regions in the southern suburb of Beirut, destroying a residential complex and claiming the lives of 12 victims, including children, and 66 wounded. These attacks have led so far to the killings of dozens of people, including children and women, to the injuring of thousands, including hundreds in a serious condition. Hundreds others were disfigured, were maimed, or even lost sight completely. This attack left hospitals and medical workers in an unprecedented emergency state, fully overwhelmed. The aggression also created a state of terror and panic among civilians in all Lebanese regions. These attacks represent a serious, unprecedented event in the history of wars, and they come in the aftermath of Israeli declarations concerning a full-scale war on Lebanon, sending Lebanon back to the Stone Age. Israel did not only launch these attacks, they were followed by official declarations and by a tweet from the advisor of their prime minister that was lately deleted,
emphasizing the responsibility of Israel and praising the positive results of this assault. This has deliberately undermined the efforts of international mediators working for a ceasefire in Gaza and South Lebanon, and has undermined all the attempts of the Lebanese government to de-escalate and exercise self-restraint. In this context, it should be noted that resorted to remotely exploding communication devices collectively with no regard to those carrying them or who are around them is considered an unprecedented method of warfare in its brutality and terror, targeting thousands of people from different age groups in densely populated areas while tending to their daily life in their homes, on streets, in workplaces, in shopping centers, is nothing but terrorism. It is a blatant violation of international humanitarian law, of international human rights law, and amounts to war crime. The first additional protocol to the Geneva Convention of 1949 pertaining to the protection of victims of armed conflicts stipulates in Article 35 that the right of parties to the conflict to choose methods of warfare is not unlimited, which means that using electronic detonation as a warfare, which is a non-conventional warfare, should be subjected to international and humanitarian laws, especially the principle of protection, meaning protecting civilians according to Article 48 and the principle of precaution, whereas all parties to the conflict should take all the necessary precautions when directing their military operations to avoid civilian loss of life and to avoid damaging civilian property. This is Article 57. The first protocol also stipulates in Article 51 the prohibition of the acts of or threats of violence, the primary purpose of which is to spread terror among civilian population. It also prohibits in Article 37 killing, injuring, or capturing an adversary using perfidy. Article 58 also prohibits using or targeting defenseless areas. Israel, through this terrorist aggression, has violated the basic principles of international humanitarian law and did not distinguish between civilians and military personnel. It has indiscriminately targeted civilians, and this operation was not justified by necessity and was not proportional either. Mr. President, it is clear that Israel does not abide by international and humanitarian law, and that it does not abide by UN resolutions and Security Council resolutions. It is clear that Israel continues to ignore the international legitimacy and human rights because it is used to never be held accountable. When Israel commits such acts, we only witness timid expressions of regret, which emboldens Israel to disregard the international resolutions, none of which has been implemented against Israel since 1948. As a result, Israel has become a rogue state. Despite all that, we cannot accept this reality as a status quo. We cannot accept to allow Israel to continue enjoying impunity. Israel did not draw any lesson from its repeated invasions of Lebanon throughout decades. Israel was repeatedly disappointed and defeated. It fled Lebanon in the year 2000, leaving behind its weapons and equipment. This new adventure that Israel is embarking on will only be another ugly version of the previous ones. It will repeat what the census war has achieved against Gaza and its children. I mean by that misery, extremism, and destruction. It might also lead to an all-out devastating regional war, that would engulf the whole Middle East with the use of lethal precise weapons and to large-scale devastation and large number of victims. Mr. President, the Lebanese people and the Lebanese government are not war lovers, and we do not seek revenge. We are only seeking justice, a diplomatic settlement, and the return of the displaced to their villages. Israel, no matter how mighty and strong it is, should understand that it cannot return its displaced to their villages with the force of weapons. Israel will be displacing those who haven't been displaced yet if they expand their attacks. Israel cannot remain in the East unless it makes peace with the peoples of this region, and this will happen by granting the Palestinians their legitimate rights and their state, which was promised to them by this organization 75 years ago. Rights shall be restored to the right holders, however long it takes. We came to this council today not only to defend Lebanon and the innocent Lebanese victims. We came to the council to protect our common humanity and to ask you to condemn the terrorist Israeli attacks clearly and unequivocally, to hold Israel accountable for planning and implementing these attacks and for violating the sovereignty of Lebanon and its territorial integrity, for violating the UN Charter and Resolution 1701. Lebanon also calls upon you to compel Israel to stop its war machinery, to avert a destructive regional war, to preserve the credibility of the United Nations and its role in maintaining international peace and security. Lebanon still believes in the relevance of international peace and security and the relevance of this council. We are not looking for a new resolution that would remain a dead letter, as is the case, unfortunately, with every resolution pertaining to Israel. Mr. President, to conclude, I would like to thank Algeria, the representative of the Arab group in the Security Council, which always stood by Lebanon and supported us in under all circumstances. I call upon the members of the Security Council to stand on the right side of history, to defend justice and peace, and to support Lebanon in its effort to achieve stability and security. This is the moment of truth, and we are resorting to the justice of the United Nations and counting on your credibility. Either this council compels Israel to stop its aggression and implement Security Council Resolutions 1701 and 2735 and end its war on all fronts, allow the return of the displaced to their villages, or we will be silent witnesses to the great explosion that is looming on the horizon. Today, and before it is too late, you have to understand that this explosion will spare neither East nor West and will take us back to the Dark Ages. The war is in front of you, and Resolutions 1701 and 2735 are in your drawers. The choice is yours. Will your August Council intervene swiftly and decisively to silence the drums of war threatening the Middle East, or will we stand idly looking? The choice is yours, and you have to choose between peace and fire. I am here to repeat this call for the third time. We are amidst a conflict, and I repeat, give peace a chance. Give peace a chance before it is too late. Didn't Israel get enough wars, conflicts, killing, and destruction? Isn't it time to end our suffering, to sow the seeds of a better future for our peoples, and to spare future generations from this conflict? Thank you, President.
I thank His Excellency Mr. Bouhabib for his statement. I now give the floor to the representative of Israel.
Thank you, Mr. President. Once again, I sit here in this council as I did on Monday, Thursday, and now Friday, defending Israel's right to exist, to defend ourselves. Also on Tuesday and Wednesday, we sat at the General Assembly for 2 days watching the Israel-bashing circus led by the Palestinian Authority as part of their diplomatic terrorism. Are there no other conflicts in the world? Are there no other pressing matters that require this Council's attention? Or is the UN's obsession with condemning Israel so consuming that it blinds you to everything else? We did not seek this war. We did not. On October 8th, while Israeli civilians were still being slaughtered in the south by Hamas, Hezbollah, I haven't heard you, Mr. Minister, mentioning Hezbollah even once in your speech. Hezbollah unleashed hundreds of rockets at our civilians in the north. This was not provoked. It was a calculated assault to show support for Hamas, a declaration made by Hassan Nasrallah himself. Since that day, over 8,000 rockets have rained down, 46 of our people have been murdered, 294 injured, and more than 60,000 remained displaced, unable to return to their homes in the north as Hezbollah attempts to burn them to the ground. Every day, Hezbollah's rockets deliberately target our civilians, attempting to destroy homes and force entire communities to flee in fear. Families have been torn apart. 12 Israeli Druze children who were playing soccer one moment were dead the next. And still, the terror continues every day. Where was the international community? Human rights? Nowhere. Every day, rockets, missiles, drones. Hezbollah's relentless attacks have forced innocent civilians, parents, children, the elderly, to abandon everything. They are now refugees within their own country, living in temporary shelters, unsure of when or if they will ever return to the places they once called home. This is not just the displacement of individuals, but of entire lives, memories, and futures. It has been nearly a year since they were forced to flee, and still they wait for the day when it will be safe to return. Israel will not allow this to continue. Our objective is very clear. We will restore security to our northern border, and we will bring our people home. It is our responsibility. The goal of returning our displaced citizens has been formally included in the objectives of this war. We will do whatever it takes to achieve this, and we will not allow Hezbollah's terror to dictate the future of our nation. If Hezbollah does not retreat from our border and back to the north of the Litani River through diplomatic efforts, Israel will be left with no choice but to use any means within our rights to defend our citizens and enable the evacuees of the north to return to their homes. Hezbollah has turned southern Lebanon into a war zone, using civilian homes as weapons depots and UNIFIL bases as launch points, digging tunnels beneath them and using innocent civilians as well as UN peacekeepers as human shields. This is not just an attack on Israel. It is a crime against Lebanon itself. Hezbollah has brought untold suffering, not just to Israelis, but to the Lebanese people, who are also trapped in the grip of this terrorist organization. If this modus operandi sounds familiar, it is because the same is used by another terror organization, Hamas, also using civilians. Yet, the Lebanese foreign minister who sits here today could not find the courage to even mention Hezbollah. We know that is a problem. If we will sit together, we can achieve very fast agreements about everything. I'm not familiar with occupation of Israel in Lebanon. I'm not familiar with major disputes. We can sit with your help and achieve some kind of a compromise. But we know that the real problem is not Lebanon. The real problem is Hezbollah. It is his government, after all, that bears the responsibility. They are incapable of implementing Security Council resolutions, nor preventing terrorist organizations from dragging their entire country into war. Minister Abdallah Abu Habib, Your Excellency, you have allowed a terrorist organization to create a state within your state, bringing ruin to your own people. Instead of blaming us, your peaceful neighbors, you should take action now to restrain Hezbollah and avoid greater escalation. If you continue to ignore Hezbollah's aggression, the pain and the suffering of the Lebanese people will be on your shoulders. Mr. President, while Israel is not seeking a wider conflict, I will be clear. We will not allow Hezbollah to continue its provocations. Their actions violate international law, and Israel will defend itself. We will not allow our people to live under constant threat, nor will we allow Hezbollah to use Lebanese territory as a launchpad for violence. For too long, we have called on this Council to enforce Resolutions 1701 and 1559. For too long, our calls have been ignored. For years, Israel has supplied data on Hezbollah's buildup in clear violation of Council resolutions, but to no avail. Hezbollah and its Iranian puppet masters must face real consequences for their actions. Hezbollah must be disarmed, and Iran must be held accountable for destabilizing the region. The world cannot afford to let Hezbollah's terror continue unchecked. We call on this Council to condemn Hezbollah and Iran and to designate Hezbollah and the Islamic Revolutionary Guard Corps as terrorist organizations. Words are no longer enough. This Council must act. For nearly a year, we have exercised restraint. We did, waiting for a diplomatic solution. And this is what we would prefer. We prefer, and we urge you, and we're thanking those who are trying to help this process. That's what we want. We have no desire for war, but we cannot continue to allow our people to bleed, nor can we abandon the 60,000 Israelis who have fled their homes. The outcome of this situation is clear. Hezbollah will be pushed back from the border, exactly as stated in Resolution 1701. The question that remains before us is how this will be achieved and at what cost. The devastation caused by Hezbollah's actions goes beyond human lives. Over 800 fires have been ignited by Hezbollah's rockets, burning more than 50,000 acres of forests, nature reserves, and agricultural land. Entire ecosystems have been destroyed. This is not just an environmental disaster. It is an act of war against the land itself. And yet, where is the UN? Where are the voices of condemnation for those who claim to care so deeply about the environment? The UN is about to convene its summit of the future. We know that climate and the environment are central themes, but where is the concern for the fire of the Hezbollah asset? Where is the outrage for the destruction of our forests, your forest in Lebanon? UN officials cannot even mention Hezbollah in their statements. This hypocrisy cannot go unchallenged. As I stated just 24 hours ago, Iran is the real instigator behind all of this. Hezbollah does not act alone. It is a puppet, and Iran is pulling the strings. Iran arms them, funds them, and directs their operations. Iran's influence stretches far beyond our borders, from Lebanon to Syria, from Yemen to Iraq. If Gaza could have been the Singapore of the Middle East, Beirut should have been the Paris of the Middle East. But we see that whatever Wherever Iran is involved, chaos and destruction inevitably follow. Mr. President, Israel will do whatever is necessary to protect its citizens. We will bring our displaced people back to their homes in the north. We will restore security, and we will bring calm to our nation. This is our right, and we will exercise it fully. The Security Council should stand by Israel as we seek to accomplish this, because this is not just Israel's fight. It is a fight against terrorism, against instability, and against the forces that seek to destroy peace in the region. When the time comes, do not look to us for blame in protecting our people. Now is your time to speak up and act before we have to. I thank you, Mr. President.
I thank the representative of Israel for their statement.
Do you want to watch more videos like this one? If yes, subscribe to our channel and press the bell icon next to it. We have decided to bring videos on something nobody talks about: African politics, economy, and increasing power. Thanks for watching, and until the next video, stay tuned.
Tell us what you think in the comment section. Like and share the video, and subscribe so that you don't miss any of our African videos. It's the best way to support us.